All right, guys, I fully understand, I fully acknowledge that not everybody has a bench grinder with a wire wheel on it, nor does everybody have a fancy bench motor like the Freeze unit that Liz and I use that has a Jacobs chuck on one end and a polishing wheel on the other. And I also understand that a lot of people aren't willing to spend the kind of money that it takes to get that Freeze unit. That thing runs at about $600 plus some of the accessories. So for the cleaning of this machine, or for her internal components, I should say, I'm going to use a very inexpensive corded rotary tool that I got at Harbor Freight. And actually, I have a bunch of these cheap ones. I also have a legit Dremel too, but I use mostly these cheap Chicago Electric ones because they just don't seem to die. Plus, they're dirt cheap. So anyway, I'm going to be using this with readily available wire brushes and other cleaning tools to clean the internal parts of this machine and to polish the internal parts of this machine. What I am going to use that is a little bit different than what most people have available, but it's readily, you know, you can easy to get. I use a rather large brick of polishing compound. I've been using this one for a while. You can see it's kind of eaten up by the buffing wheels, and I keep it in a drawer down on the lower side, right side of my bench here. So if you see my reaching down with the rotary tool and then coming back up, that's probably what I'm doing, is recharging the buffing wheel that's on. But anyway, we're going to start with the feed dog rock shaft on this machine, and the bearing that's on the end of the arm where the feed dog attaches, that's supposed to spin freely. This one is locked up solid, and it's got a ton of crud on it. So I'm going to take a dental instrument here and see how bad that really is. Yeah, it's getting away some of the stuff out of the way, but that bearing is just seized up. So now I use Kroil. Everybody knows I'm a big fan of Kroil in the aerosol form, but I also buy it in the 8-ounce can, and then I dispense it into, I decant it down to the small needle oiler bottles. So I'm going to put a little bit of Kroil on here, and it just takes a drop or two. Let that sit for a couple minutes, and get a paper towel here, set that on. I'm going to take a pair of pliers and just lightly grip this. Yep, it's starting to move now, okay? But it's still pretty well crudded up, so we're going to get a little bit more oil on there. And now I'm going to take my blazer torch and apply a little heat to that. It'll just burn some of the crud out of there. Now take the pliers again. Yeah, that's freeing it up considerably now. And I'm not grabbing hard on this. I'm just lightly gripping that. I'm not doing anything that's going to mar that bearing surface. But yeah, it's starting to come loose. So now, down at the top of the bearing, you see there's a piece that's peened in over the bearing itself. So I'm going to put some oil on this top surface, and hopefully that'll get down in there. And once again, lightly grip it, move it until it loosens up. And we might add a little bit more heat to that later. But the idea here is to let the oil get in there. Because remember, new oil will trump old oil. Old oil that turned to varnish, new oil will loosen it up. So you might have to flush it a couple of times. And by flushing here, we're only talking a drop or two. And you could probably get away with using regular sewing machine oil for this. I use penetrating oil more out of habit than anything else. I'll confess to that. But, yeah, that's freeing up nicely now. And looking at it, there's some marring on the plating. but it's not really marring. It's crud that's built up on the plating. So, I'm going to use the larger diameter wire brush. And on this tool, first of all, with wire brushes, I always start at the slowest speed when I start it up. But this size, I don't really bring up to any really more than 2 for speed. There we go. Yeah, maybe 2.5 or 3. And I'm just going to go through, get some of the crud off of this area here. Now, it's important, of course, to wear safety glasses when you're doing this. I always wear... all of my eyeglasses are safety glasses. I never have any glasses that aren't, you know, that the glasses are not safety glass. And I've got a couple of pair of eyeglasses that have the, what I like to call the birth control wings on them. I use those mostly in the wood shop. I should be using them here. I will confess at the moment I'm not. But I'm also being very careful to keep the axis of the rotation of the wheel away from, so that when it, if it flings something, it's not going to fling something into my eyes or into my face. Alright, let's see how we did here. That got a lot of that crud off that area. This whole portion is nice and clean. Got a lot of the crud off. That's moving smoother. But I want to get some more oil in there and under. And this time, I'm going to use my flameless heater. This is what I use for shrinking heat shrink tubing. Just want to apply the heat, not the flame. And I want to see what this does, if this is going to... There's a little too much oil on there. Okay. Got some heat on that. Now let's twist that again. Lightly. Lightly gripping. Lightly gripping. There we go. All right, that's fully freed up now, and that feels good. Okay, so, grab this paper towel here. We'll continue the march and do the rest of this rock shaft pretty much the same way, knocking off the worst of the schmutz, with the wire wheel. Now, one thing you got to be concerned about, especially with these smaller wire wheels, if you're moving a lot of dirt with them, you can clog up the wire wheel. And essentially then what you're doing is you're moving dirt from one point to another. You're smearing it. So you might want to take, if the parts are especially grungy, take them to the sink. Use a scrub brush, some hot water, and a degreaser like Dawn dish soap. Once again, not a sponsor. I know I mentioned Dawn a lot. No, they're not a sponsor. But as their marketing says, it gets grease out of your way. They are not kidding. It's probably, as far as non-industrial strength degreasers goes, Dawn dish soap is probably one of the best as a degreaser. You might have your own favorite, that's mine. You know, like I always say, you use what works for you, and just telling you what works for me. Anyway, I'm going to go through, going to knock the major crud off of this. Of course, with the bench motor, or with the bench grinder and a wire wheel, the amount of time it's going to take me to do just this rock shaft, the fork, and the connecting rod, you know, I could have gone out to dinner and rebuilt two more machines. Well, maybe not that much, but this is a lot slower than using a big bench grinder would be. You know, even a 6-inch bench grinder, this is a lot slower. It's also more humbling. It's like, oh my God, am I really going to be this dedicated to do this? If you have done it this way, let me know down in the comments. If you have done it this way, and then before you did another machine, went out and bought a bench grinder with a wire wheel, let me know down in the comments. It's been a long time since I've done one of these strictly with a rotary tool. I'm going to take a little bit of sewing machine oil. Let's put a couple drops on here. I'll put a little line of it on here and wipe this down. And that'll pick up a lot of the dirt that the rotary tool loosened up. Granted, this is not as pretty as what I can get it with a bench grinder, but we're looking for functional here more than pretty. Oops, I want to get that. Okay. I did not use a fresh wire wheel either. That's one that's been around for a while. Okay. That is not perfect, but it is certainly good. So I'm going to call the feed dog rock shaft done. Next, we'll take the connecting rod. This is the rod that connects the vertical shaft to the bell crank. Start by wiping off some schmoo. This one really should go to the sink for hot water and Dawn, but rather than go to the sink, I'm going to take a sip of coffee. And what I'm going to do on this one, got a piece of paper towel down, put some sewing machine oil on it, and I'm going to use a strip of Scotch-Brite and some motion here to do a little scrubby-dub, just showing you various ways you can clean this stuff. Scotch-Brite, I buy this in, I think these are 6x9 sheets. It's like a six-pack of them that I buy, and I generally cut them across the width about an inch at a shot. And you'll see this is going to work extremely well to get this clean. Okay, now this obviously will work on this. It might not work on another part. Like, I wouldn't do the hook with this method, but I can get the big flat areas done. Now I'm going to use a block of wood here to back this up so I don't bend it. I'm just going to move it along the block of wood. And I'm going to go back along with the rotary tool, the wire wheel, to do the curved portions at the end. But you can see here, so I hope you can see, that the just a little bit of sewing machine oil and the Scotch-Brite pad, a bit of fresh oil on here, up this way, just a little bit of sewing machine oil and a Scotch-Brite pad is taking most of the crud off of this part. Wipe it down, clean paper towel, and you see that looks considerably better than it did before. Now, I can take along the side edges, lather, rinse, repeat, just go along the sides, get these edges cleaned up. That doesn't take much effort. Once again, I'm only doing the straight portions with that. And wipe down the link once again. And that's pretty good. So now, all that's left to do on this, take our rotary tool with a wire brush and get the stuff that you can't get readily with the pad of Scotch-Brite. Get all that crud that's built up on there. That'll just knock it off. So you can see there's all sorts of different ways you can attack these parts. You see that mark there? It's right off. All these hard to get stained areas and areas where the stuff's caked on. The wire wheel handle that. With relatively easier stuff, we just got with the Scotch-Brite pad. All right, let's wipe this down again on both ends. Now, if I was going to get really super fancy, I would take the screws out of either end and really go a little more on that, which I probably will before I assemble this. But once again, we get into these end pieces, get some oil in there, clean these out. But there's something else we can use too. Once we get the worst of that out, let me grab, I have a second rotary tool here. Actually, I have a couple. I've got like four of them hanging out here. And what I like to use in, What I like to use in these connecting rod ends, I take a felt polishing point of appropriate size. This is close enough. This one's actually borderline on too big, but it's close enough. And I get this in. I'll charge this up with a little bit of white compound. And then go ahead and clean and polish the inside of that rod end. Give a little bit more. Lather, rinse, repeat on the other side. And now, we'll take another cotton swab. Might take more than one. Clean these out. Get all the buffing dirt out of here. It's going to take more than one Q-tip to clean these out. That builds up a lot. So, get the schmoo out. And what we wind up with is a highly polished bearing surface. And once again, bearing surfaces, the cleaner and shinier they are, the less drag you have, the better your machine's going to run. And the whole point of this operation is to make a nice, smooth running machine. Otherwise, what are we doing this for if we're not going to make the machine run nice and smooth? So, name of the game is friction reduction, kids. And that looks pretty good. We'll go back in there later and clean that out a little bit more. Now for the fork, for the stitch length regulator, of course we have the bearing that goes with that. I'm going to put a little bit of Kroil on this because I know this is going to be difficult to get off at best. Let's see if I'm going to grab an appropriate size screwdriver. See if this is going to come off easily. No, it is not. So, rather than hurt myself, come on, get in there. Well, that's not going in there all the way. Maybe a slightly narrower one. That's the one I want. Okie doke. All right. There we go. Get the screw out. Now, notice the orientation, too. The screw went in on the side where the swoop is. So if the swoop is going to the right, that's the side the screw is going to go in. Also, another way, you know, to find it is look at the side where the bearing goes will be where it's the side where it's offset, where these offset pieces are facing up. So make sure you pay attention to how it came apart. Otherwise, you're going to be sitting there scratching your head wondering why your stitch length regulator doesn't work. This one, I think we're going to do the same thing. We're going to use some sewing machine oil on this piece of Scotch-Brite and just scrub. And actually, the feed dog rock shaft, this is really the best way of doing that too, but I wanted to show you with the wire wheel. Here. That's just one side. You can see the difference. Clean, dirty. Clean, dirty. All right? So yeah, there's a method to the madness here. We want these parts to be clean. So we do a scrub-a-dub-dub. And just like on the big, large surface areas, we're doing the scrub here. Now that's considerably better than it was. These upper areas, like where the bolt goes through, the pivot point for the bearing, I'm going to do that with the rotary tool and the wire wheel. And actually, hold on. I'm going to change tools out here for a second. There's another rotary tool that also should be in everybody's toolkit. Or I should say another bit for the rotary tool. And I've been ignoring them. I've got them in four different grits. The brown ones are 120, the greens are 180, the reds are 320, and the blacks are 400. These are like rotary tool Scotch-Brite pads. They don't last a super long time, but man, do they work nice. Check it out. This is the 120 grit one. Let me start on a side I haven't done anything. You see this here? See how grungy that is? I have to support this with my hand, so I'll come back up for air and show you again in just a second. All right. See what that looks like now. See the end here? Can even get inside here, inside the fork with it. And I'll have a link to these. I get these from Amazon. I'll have a link to the kit that comes with a whole bunch of these down in the description down below. And you'll see why I like using rotary tools too. Likewise, on this end, you get all this crapola off of here. And honestly, if you go to the, if you work this stuff to up the grits to 400, you can actually do a fairly decent job of rough polishing with these. Definitely a nice job of cleaning. So there, that's one of the dirtiest parts of this machine. And how long did that take? Not long at all. So let's look at the screw, shall we? Now, I'm not going to just be foolish enough to just try to hold that. I'm going to use my engineer PZ56 screw repair pliers. Get the crud out of the threads. Get the crud off along the perimeter. Now that screw head got a little damaged. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to pull out a jeweler's file. I'm just going to take a flat one. And I'm going to use a file. Actually, I'm going to put that in a hole here. And I'm going to file off the areas where it got a little chowdered. Just lightly filing. I'm not really wailing on it. Just going lightly over the surface. Getting that off. Okay. And now we'll go back to, actually we'll leave this in a hole here. We'll go back to some polishing compound on a hard felt. Didn't need to drop that. Once again, magnet on a stick. It's your best friend in the shop sometimes. Especially if you're older and you really don't feel like bending over a lot. Okay, so we still have this section here to contend with. And that, Scotch-Brite will handle that. Okay, go ahead, reinstall this, okay, swoop down to the right, reinstall this back into the forked arm, it's plenty tight. Now we just have to contend with the bearing. How to do the bearing is actually easier than you might think. I know trying to hold this would be a bit of a pain in the ass. So what I'm going to use is I've got a small bottle brush. That one's too big actually. Let me take a smaller bottle brush. And I'm going to throw a little bit of oil down the hole. Take the bottle brush over a piece of paper towel and clean out the inside of the bearing surface. Okay, that wipes that out. Let me grab a fresh paper towel here. That one's getting kind of disgusting. All right, throw that one. Now, you see this is getting pretty gross. I'm going to put some oil on this just to loosen up the crud. All righty. Oh look, that one fits this punch. Which size is this punch? This is a 3/16. That fits on there pretty well. Actually, it's a little small. A little large, I should say. Let me find a different punch. 3/16 is close, so we'll try 11/64. That's one from my pen disassembly slash reassembly set from Penn State Industries. It's actually tools for woodworking, for pen making at the lathe. That set of punches is great for disassembling pen kits, but it's also phenomenal for general workshop use. I use it for all sorts of things in here. And let me grab another buffing wheel. Okay. Our friend Debbie gave me this kit. And let me put some little compound on this. And once again, using two hands, one hand to stabilize and to position the bearing and move the bearing on the shaft that I made here from that punch, and the other hand to control the rotary tool, which is doing the dog work here of the polishing. And I'm actually getting a nice mirror finish out of that. Now, the perimeter now is done. I'm just going to do the face. And to do the face, I'm going to put it on the fork initially. Once again, I'm going to use one finger to support and control. And move things. And let me get a little more compound on that. Heated that up a little bit. It's got to cool off. There we go. Now it's moving again. There we go. Clean and shiny. Take that off. We'll flip it over. Lather, rinse, repeat on this side. Now keep in mind, I'm putting a heck of a lot of compound on and a lot of heat onto this little bearing. So it's actually expanding and it's grabbing hold of that inner pivot. There, it is now clean. Wipe it down. Goes back on with a drop of oil. Actually put a little drop of oil underneath. And bada bing, bada boom, that fork and bearing is done. So, what other techniques can we use? Let's take a look. Let's take a look at some of the other types of stuff. Alright, this will work. Let me get my block of wood that I dropped on the shop floor here a moment ago. Okay, I'm a huge advocate of having a couple of scraps of blocks of wood around. It makes a lot of things much easier. So this is the slack thread regulator, which is a little different than the ones that you're used to on the more modern 66s and 99s. And by the way, speaking of more modern 66s and 99s, I was checking something this morning off camera. Something seemed a little strange when I was disassembling this machine yesterday. This is the needle bar for this 1918 era 99. Unlike a more modern 99 or most other Singer machines, needle bar in the new machines are 250 thousandths, you know, a quarter of an inch. This is 187 thousandths. It is smaller, which means also that the needle bar clamp is smaller. And good luck finding these parts if you happen across an old 99. So something you got to be cognizant of. Not all machines have interchangeable parts. Yeah, I could probably find a way to drill out the body casting to put a modern needle bar in that, but no, that ain't going to happen. So, yeah, keep that in mind. Some of these machines, the parts are different sized. Anyway, let's go back, and we're going to tackle this with a 180 grit first, just to get the schmoo off. There's a lot of schmoo. getting the worst of the shmoo. There's a lot of shmoo on this side. See that? And oh look, the shmoo is gone. And this is at 180 grit. I'm not using super fine, I'm not using super coarse. This is like a medium grit. So now, having done that, I'm gonna use the white compound. Now on this, let me qualify this first before I go polishing. I don't technically have to polish this portion back here because it's not going to be seen, but I'm going to because I'm anal retention. So, because we went with a medium grit instead of a super coarse grit, the polishing on this is going to be relatively easy. Like I said, I'm using a white compound. Now, right at the moment, this first pass, I'm only going back as far as the first screw. I'm doing that for so I don't burn the crap out of my hand. Which I'm already doing. This is already getting really freaking hot. This is another one of those parts that ordinarily I would take to the buffing wheel, and I'd buff it really quick. And honestly, I think this is going to look even better. One nice thing about using hard felt buffing wheels is they don't shed like the cloth ones do. So it's not snowing in here right now like it is when I use the standard muslin wheels or cotton wheels or whatever they're made out of. All right, I'm going to let that cool for a couple seconds. Not touching this without paper towel because this is really freaking hot. There, but you can see, so far, that's come up absolutely gorgeous. You remember what that looked like? When this cools off a bit more. Ah, now I'll just do it now. God hates a coward. Why put off for tomorrow what I can do today? Hatsibatsi. And there we go. Wipe the shmoo off. The buffing dirt comes right off. And we have a beautiful part, which is burning the crap out of my fingers at the moment. But yeah, she buffed up real nice. Oh, let's see what else we can do. We can tackle the needle bar. What the heck? This needle bar is actually pretty clean. What I would recommend doing... Actually, no, let's not do the needle bar. Let's do the presser foot, because the presser foot's filthy. The needle bar got cleaned in the way I was getting it out of the machine. This presser bar is disgusting. So... we'll start, once again, we'll use, actually no, let's go to a black 400 grit on this. And I'll give you an idea what the 400 grits can do. This is going to put less scratches in this. And once again, I'm going to stabilize this on the bench and using the block of wood to have other points of contact, and I'm going to be, once I get this thing rolling, I'm going to probably be choking up on it. So, and right now I got a speed set at about 3.5. You see how much that came off right away. All this crud, It's just knocking it right off. Now this is the finest grit of these Scotch-Brite pads in the kit. It only goes up to 400 grit. You don't want to spend a tremendous amount of time with the Scotch-Brite on it. You want to keep it moving as much as you can. You You can see it's getting that crud right off of this pressure bar. Now these Scotch Brite wheels do shed. They shed a bit. So once again, safety glasses are a real good idea. All right, that's the most. That's the majority of that. Oh, get the end. Can't forget the end. Okay, majority of that is off. Get that hanging on its hook, and then we'll polish this down. Once again, we're going to use about a 1-inch diameter felt. You can see how that cleans up real nice and polishes real well. So yeah, you don't necessarily have to have a fancy setup. Fancy setup definitely makes it go quicker. And I'll show you some screw heads this way too. You know, you all seen me do it in the bench motor to polish the screw heads using nail files. All right, let's let this cool off a little bit because I got to hold this thing in the other direction. Actually, I'm going to hold it with paper towel because my parents didn't raise any stupid children that lived. And once again, we do the same thing with the needle bar. The needle bar will polish up exactly the same way. I'm using this one as the demo. Because this was so much dirtier than the needle bar was. The needle bar, like I said, got very much cleaned up when it was removed from the machine because of the amount of penetrating oil I had to get on there to knock off the schmoo. All right, this is really hot now. So we're just going to wipe this down. Okay, hot. You can see what that did. That came up really freaking nice. And you saw it in real time. I'm not editing that for time. That worked really, really well. All right, we'll do the needle bar. What the heck? Needle bar, same way. I'm just slowly rotating the needle bar in my fingers here. I go down the length of it. Swing it around. Oh yeah, that's warm. That's warm. There we go. Wipe this down, and the needle bar is factory fresh, or at least quite beautiful. Alrighty, other parts that need... Hold on. I know what we need to show. We need to pull the hook out of this mess, because this hook had a lot of schmoo in it. Alright, you see all the crud that's in that hook. Let me see if I can get the camera angle. I'm looking up at my Cisco unit that's my monitor for this. You can see all the crud that's in there. Alright, this is how we're going to clean that. Let me get a smaller diameter wire wheel. That's a relatively fresh one. I opened a new package. There's like 5 or 6 different wire wheels that comes with each package at Harbor Freight. And I had opened up a new package the other day. I forgot what I was working on at the time. So let's put in the smaller diameter wire wheel, and we are going to get the inside of this hook cleaned out. So once again, you can see what that inside looks like. It's disgusting. So here we go. Speed 3.5. Gonna go in here, running it inside the track, knock out all this crud. Actually, let's get get it on the wooden block. Get that knocked down. And we'll lightly, very, very lightly knock the outside off. Get the major welded crud off of here. At the base where the oil is built up and turned to varnish, we'll get that knocked off with a wire wheel. And we'll just go along the length, cleaning that a little bit. Alright, yeah, it does sound like the bearings on that rotary tool are starting to go, but that rotary tool is ancient. Okay, now, that knocked off the worst of the crud. Now it's just a matter of polishing. Once again, felt wheel, compound. Now here I've got some holes drilled in. Of course, not one that's the right size, so. Alright, forget I mentioned that. We'll start on the bottom. Now this is going to have grooves in it because of the way it's machined. These weren't intended to be completely polished, the bottom side of that. The shaft, yes, the shaft, we can polish the shaft. The bottom side of the hook is not intended to be gloss polished. See how much schmoo we got off. Looks we got it all. Okay. Gonna grip that with paper towel because once again that's hot as hell. And I'm just gonna do this. I'm going side to side, slowly rotating the hook and slowly going side to side with the polishing wheel. Compound on there. The areas that you want to make sure are polished super smooth will be blatantly obvious. You're going to want to go all the way around slowly, side to side, making sure you get the top surface as well. Almost through this one. You have to keep a good firm grip on your tooling as well as on your part. We're almost there. Now some brands of rotary tools, such as Dremel, I believe have a stand that you can mount the tool in to hold the tool while you're bringing things to the tool. I don't have one of those, and I'm not honestly sure how well it would work for this. But if you've got it, try it. Let me know how it works. Put something down in the comments. No secrets here, guys. We're all here to help each other. Now I'm going to get this inside surface here, and I'm going to get along inside the track where we cleared it with the wire wheel. There we go. Let me wipe this down real quick. Yeah, it's pretty warm. And there you go. That is a clean and polished, freshly cleaned, freshly polished hook. That should not have any problems whatsoever. So, you can see how we're going through that. The tools I'm using, the techniques, it's not rocket science. There's nothing secretive about this. I think I showed you enough Oh, no, let's do a couple of pieces of hardware. Let's do a couple of screws before we end this. Because I get questions, a lot of questions about how I do screws. So we'll find a couple of different sizes. And find one more here. Here we go. Here's a couple pieces of hardware, bigger hardware. All right. Y'all know that I love my engineer screw holding pliers, screw repair pliers. So I'm going to start this off by hand, small wire wheel, and just go around the circumference cleaning out the threads of the screw. Doing that first. All right. Now, we'll hold that in the screw repairing pliers. Now, I've got a couple different sizes of these. This is the ones that are most useful for this. And let me get this hardware out of the way. Once again, I'm going to brace my hand. And I'm going to use this to get the bearing surface where all the oil winds up. Get the varnish off of that by rotating the wire brush around on that surface. And then real quick, gonna knock the varnish off the top and off the edge. Now this screw did not get chowdered up at all, so there's no repair there. Once again, back to polishing bonnet, or felt polishing wheel. Just going around the perimeter of the bearing surface first. Actually, I'm gonna grip that a little bit farther out. Going around the bearing surface, get the bearing surface good and clean, good and shiny. Put that back in, oops. Then go around the head of the screw. A little more compound. And then across the face of the screw. And we wind up with a very hot, this is scorching hot, but a very good looking, clean, threads and all, clean, good looking screw, you know, good looking part. Likewise, we can do that with smaller screws. Let me find my smaller screw holding pliers here. Here's my PZ57s. I'm gonna do the head of this first. This is actually a, this screw is the needle plate screw. I'm just gonna hit the head of that. You can see how nicely that polished up. Let's see. Oh, okay. This is the eccentric bolt for the stitch length regulator arm to the feed dog rock shaft. So, once again, we got to get the crud out of the threads of this one. This one's crudded up pretty good. Look at those threads clear. And we use the 56s to hold while we use the while we clear the crud off the bearing surface, the edge of the head, and the face of the bolt. Now we'll switch over. And we'll use the polisher. We'll polish that bearing surface. So this is a pivot point. You want that clean and polished. And then we'll do the head up as well. Why? Because we can and we take pride in our work. Oh yeah, there you go. That looks great. That will function great, which is more important than just looking great. So when this goes into that pivot point here, into the small end of the rod here, that's going to have very, very little friction. I am burning the crap out of my hands holding that piece. And one thing I didn't get, and you guys are going to yell at me for, I didn't get the end of this. There we go. Varnish is gone. I know somebody was getting ready to type a comment or type me an email. Other things, you can do the same thing, wire wheels and such, to do things like the pivot screws. These I do like to do in the bench motor, but for the sake of democracy here, putting a pivot screw in this with this opened up just a little bit, and I'm just going to go over the pivot point of this. You'll be able to see how the pivot point will clean up. Now, this is going to take more work than it normally does in the bench motor, because in the bench motor, I'm doing this with foam cord nail files and really getting this crap off. But, yeah, you can do it this way. Just saying. Not going to go through the whole thing, because I don't want this video to be 20 years long. And once again, clean the nuts the same way. That's going back in there, because that needs more cleaning. So yeah, that's pretty much all I've got for you on this one. I think I showed you the various techniques, the important techniques you need to know for cleaning these internal parts. I have to be at work in another hour. So that's all I'm going to get done on this. So thank you all so much for watching the A 99 for Sandy Part 2. Part 3, all of these component parts will be cleaned, and we will start reassembly of this beautiful Singer Model 99K from 1918. So thank you so much for watching. We'll see you on the next one.